Good morning. Lovely to see all your masked faces. Remember, if you're sitting close to someone else with whom you do not live, that you have your mask over your nose. Obviously, if you have an health issue and you can't wear a mask, totally understandable. Love the Cubs. Welcome to Duke. But if you want to buy me a Cubs one shell hammers, I'll be good with it. It's fine. A few announcements this morning on this first Sunday back in 3.5 months, but this very different Sunday. You will notice that the projector is on this morning, which means our screens and projectors did not get installed this last week. We're hoping by next Sunday they will be in here. Let us pray for that, because it would make life a lot easier. Also, we're looking for volunteers of people who know how to run PowerPoint, who can help flip through slides once we get everything in. And I'm looking at some of my kids in Sunday school, because I know you guys, they've taught me how to use my MacBook, so I know they can do this. And so if you're willing to help out, please let Beth or Susan Powell know. Or even just let me know, because we're definitely going to need that help. I have like a whole list of announcements. Remember that we are not gathering for fellowship before or after service. I thank you all for coming in and coming straight to the sanctuary. That's something that we do have to abide by right now. Also, you'll notice that even downstairs on the water fountain, we can't use the water fountain. There are a list of things that we can and can't do. And this is very frustrating, as I keep saying to you all in these worship videos. Very frustrating, I understand. It's very frustrating for your church leadership, because we have to keep changing plans on how we do things. And so now we just sit and wait to see what July 14th brings. I will say your leadership is a bit concerned after the 4th of July weekend and people gathering, and then the 4-H fair and the county fair coming up and people being very close together. And so, as I keep saying, if there comes a point when we need to go back online or do some sort of a hybrid of one Sunday in, one Sunday out, just to reduce the times we're together, we will do that. We'll make that decision, but you guys will know ahead of time. You should have communion, your little cup. Very different. Tastes very different than Grandma Lois's bread, I'm telling you. But to help yourself out, right before communion starts, you might want to tiny peel the top layer for the wafer. I struggled a bit the other day when practicing and ended up throwing the juice everywhere. So that's just an FYI. You'll notice that there are four stations, one in the lounge, two in the back, and one in the hallway. Masks, gloves, hand sanitizer, communion, where you drop off your offering. You'll notice in the service that we don't have a time for offering, because it doesn't make sense if we're not passing it around. So the service will continue to evolve and look different. But of course, those stations are there, and as always, you can mail them into the church, you can drop them in the slot, you can drop them at the office. I know we just came back, but I've been working the whole time. I will be unavailable from July 6th until Saturday the 18th. Next Sunday, Reverend Ellen Corcella will be here. Most of you should know Ellen. She's been here several times. Fantastic preacher. And so she is willing to come in and preach. Thanks to Lindsay, who offered to do special music this morning. Lindsay's in the back. And if you are a visitor or someone who's been here but you rely on the bulletin to know responses, don't worry about that today. Hopefully by next week we'll have both screens up, and Susan Powell and Beth and whomever will work on the PowerPoints, and we'll literally have everything on the walls. And so everything that you'll need, all the responses will be there. For today, we'll run off this, so I will play double duty and running the projector as well. I think I got all the, oh, tomorrow the office will be closed. Tomorrow is Susan's day off for the 4th. Since Friday, she only works half days. She takes Monday off. And so just remember that if you need something from Susan, she won't be in until Tuesday. I think that concludes my like 70-point list of announcements this morning. I know it will be weird that we're not gonna be able to sing, but we have Eileen up there filling in for Susan, filling in for Judy. And we're grateful that Eileen is with us this morning, and so we will have beautiful music even if we are not singing. And so let us worship our God.
Please stand for the call to worship, and please look to the front for your responses. The Lord listens to us in times of trouble and joy.
We call to the Lord in our anxiety and fear.
God will not turn away from us.
God will heal and restore us.
The Lord of life enters into our spirits. Join me in unison prayer. Gracious and loving God, come to us in our fears and frustrations. We feel unable to serve and often beaten down by life. Give us courage and strength and help us joyfully serve you by serving others. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Please be seated.
Obviously, I can't do two things at once. We come to this time of joys and concerns a little faster this morning than we normally do. Also, you'll notice we're not passing around a mic at this time. However, Joanne Hobbs has a mic this morning and would like to share. So, Joanne, if you would like to.
Yes. That's what it is. I couldn't remember what that was. Okay. I wanted to thank you. We, as you all know, if you read your church bulletin, we had our 70th wedding anniversary July 1st. And we got a lot of cards, and I want to, if I can't get to everybody and thank you individually, I want to thank you all now, because we really got a lot of them. So thank you.
You're welcome. Congratulations. This morning we're doing obviously a little differently. On Sundays, if you have a joy, if you have a concern to share, please let those who are ushering, those who are greeting know, or let Widner know ahead of time. However we can convey the information, we will. I have a note that Pat Brooks's mom fell at home due to low blood sugar and was at the emergency room, and so we want to pray for Pat's mother, and please let us know as she feels better or anything else. She's home now, okay. So please let us know if we need to pray for something else, but we pray that she be stable and that she be all right, especially going in and out of an emergency room right now is a very scary thing. We want to pray for Ann Votaw's dad, Phil Good, pastor. Phil hasn't been doing well for quite a while. And so Roger and Ann are going to go down to Texas this next week and visit him. And so prayers for safe travels as well. And also, speaking of Roger and Ann, tomorrow is their 29th wedding anniversary. You guys don't look old enough to have a 29th anniversary. Well, that's true. He does not act old enough to have a 29th. I mean, they did get married a little before you. Anne's looking a little concerned suddenly. Do you use math in teaching science? Obviously. Scott Billings uses math. He'll teach you. I also have a note this morning that we want to pray for the Urschel family. Linda Urschel's mother is in hospice care. Also, Linda's not here, right? I'm scanning the room. We also want to pray for Linda. If you're not aware, she fell last week and gashed her head open, 27 stitches to close it, has a concussion. And so want to keep Linda in our prayers as she's dealing with a lot right now. I know Sharon talks to her quite frequently, but I'm sure she would love to hear from others as well. This morning, we also come with sadness as Belinda joins us. Our beloved David Rinkenberger died on Thursday. Dave's visitation will be from 4 to 8 on Wednesday at Grand Staff Hinken. And then the funeral will be at 10 a.m. on Thursday morning at the funeral home with Reverend Carolyn Reed, our associate regional minister, officiating. Carolyn so graciously agreed, since she's known Belinda and Dave a long time, since I will be out of the state. And so, Belinda, we pray for you and Christy and Jeff and the rest of the family. And as always, let us know what you need. I will say that Christy, when sitting with her the other day, while sitting with Dave, kept saying how grateful she is to have this church family, how growing up she was grateful, how when she had Damon she was grateful coming as a single mom and being so accepted, but how she's watched her parents be so loved in the last 2 years, and to know that this congregation will continue to support Belinda. I also add that I would appreciate your prayers. I know Toby's family, especially his mother, would appreciate your prayers. Tuesday is the first anniversary of Toby's death, and so that's why I'm taking a leave and going out of town. But I know that especially his mother, that will be a very hard day, and so they would appreciate. Let us pray. Holy and gracious God, we come this morning thankful that we can be together in person. God, we come this morning adhering to precautions, thinking right now that this worship service seems a little strange, but God, also be comforted by the fact that we are surrounded by our family, that no matter what happens in the world, no matter what happens and changes in this service, the basics are the same. The basics being you and loving our neighbors as ourselves. God, we celebrate with Meryl and Joanne 70 years, quite a feat. God, we celebrate with Roger and Ann 29 years, also quite a feat. But God, we come this morning praying for those who are ill. God, praying for those who are broken. Continuing to pray for those many in our congregation dealing with dementia in their families. God, we come as a congregation grieving the loss of one of our beloved elders this morning. And God, we know that you are with Belinda and the rest of their family. God, we continue to pray for those facing uncertain times, those who are scared. God, we currently live in a time frame where everything is fluid, and that's terrifying, especially if we find ourselves to be not so flexible. And so, God, this morning as the church, we pray that we be able to be flexible, that we be able to roll with whatever happens in terms of this pandemic, because we know that no matter what happens, we are your children and we are called to serve. God, we pray all of this in the name of Jesus, the Christ, our Lord. Amen. For the first time in like years since I've been here, I'm not going to be overshadowed by the choir. So there's, just kidding. I can't wait till the choir comes back. I'm so excited for that day. This morning we focus on Genesis 21, 8 through 21. Hagar and Ishmael sent away. The child grew and was weaned, and Abraham made a great feast on the day that Isaac was weaned. But Sarah saw the son of Hagar the Egyptian, whom she had borne to Abraham, playing with her son Isaac. So she said to Abraham, "Cast out the slave woman with her son, for the son of the slave woman shall not inherit along with my son Isaac." The matter was very distressing to Abraham on account of his son. But God said to Abraham, "Do not be distressed because of the boy and because of your slave woman. Whatever Sarah says to you, do as she tells you, for it is through Isaac that offspring shall be named for you. And for the son of the slave woman, I will make a nation of him also, because he is your offspring." So Abraham rose early in the morning and took bread and a skin of water and gave it to Hagar, putting it on her shoulder along with the child, and sent her away. And she departed and wandered about in the wilderness of Beersheba. When the water and the skin was gone, she cast the child under one of the bushes. Then she went and sat down opposite him a good way off, about the distance of a bow shot. For she said, "Do not let me look on the death of the child." And as she sat opposite him, she lifted up her voice and wept. And God heard the voice of the boy, and the angel of God called to Hagar from heaven and said to her, "What troubles you, Hagar? Do not be afraid, for God has heard the voice of the boy where he is. Come, lift up the boy and hold him fast with your hand, for I will make a great nation of him." And then God opened her eyes, and she saw a well of water. She went and filled the skin with water and gave the boy a drink. God was with the boy, and he grew up. He lived in the wilderness and became an expert with the bow. He lived in the wilderness of Paran, and his mother got a wife for him from the land of Egypt. This morning, we're going to talk about the word distressed. And I have to admit that every time I hear the word, I'm momentarily transported back into time to being a teenager, which actually was longer ago than you think it was. And I remember my Grandpa Poe saying, I could have dragged those behind my car and put holes in them and made them look old when he saw someone wearing a pair of distressed jeans. I know those came popular in the 70s. We'll show a hands of all the generations who have worn distressed jeans. Scott, I need photos. I need photos, Mr. Billings. However, this morning we focus on the seriousness of the word distressed and how it means to be full of anxiety, sorrow, and pain. Earlier in the book of Genesis, when Sarah thought there was never going to be a day when she would give Abraham an heir, she said to Abraham, "Hey Abraham, let me give you my slave girl Hagar. She'll give you a son." And it seems without any conversation at all with Hagar, the Egyptian slave girl, she's given to Abraham, and of course she has a son with him. But then things get interesting because Sarah becomes pregnant, even at her advanced age, and they have a son. And things should be good, right? Abraham has two sons by two ladies. What could go wrong? He's fulfilling the promise. Not only does he have one son, he has two. The promise doubled. But of course, human nature happens, jealousy happens, fear happens, and it has all the elements of a daytime soap opera, or at least an episode of the Maury Povich show. If you're flipping channels through the day, you know what I mean. We're told that Isaac has been weaned and Abraham is throwing a feast, so we know that Isaac is toddlerish age right now. And everyone is probably having a good time and celebrating family, but Sarah sees her son playing with Hagar's son. She sees these brothers playing together as they should. They should be growing up together, knowing each other. But something doesn't sit right with Sarah. The jealousy monster comes to play. She looks at Ishmael with envy. Before Sarah could have her own child, this is how things had to be. But now that her son Isaac has survived infancy, she doesn't seem too keen on the idea that her husband has a firstborn child that isn't hers. Isaac is a gift. Sarah sees him as a miracle. She sees Ishmael as a child who was born out of determination and planning on her part. She sees that her son isn't technically the rightful heir, and Sarah realizes that Isaac is the second born, and she has to wonder if her child really is the child of promise, or if Ishmael will be the child of the future because he is his father's firstborn. And all of this thinking must have been distressing to her. It obviously was distressing because then she goes to Abraham and she says, "Cast out this slave woman with her son, for the son of the slave woman shall not inherit along with my son Isaac." Ouch. Ishmael was born out of Sarah's planning, and now she says, "Take him away. Get rid of him. Hagar and Ishmael are disposable to Sarah," proving that Hagar really is property. She's been given to Abraham. She's given him a son, and now she seems disposable. But on top of that yuckiness, the child is disposable. This isn't the nice image we like to have of Sarah, the mother of the nations, the mother of our faith. This isn't the cozy grandma in a rocking chair by the fireplace. This is more like the women, the white women, who were the wives of plantation owners during the Southern U.S. slavery, who would cast off, they would sell the children of their husbands and the slave women. We'd much prefer to have that rocking chair fireplace image of Sarah. We're told that Abraham is distressed because Ishmael is his son, but apparently not so distressed that he says, "Hey, Sarah, not gonna happen." Keep in mind that men ruled the society, and so he could have said, "Not gonna happen," but he doesn't say, "Nope, we're not doing that." And verse 12 is interesting. We're told that God jumps into the conversation. We don't know if Abraham prayed about it or if the word of God just came to him. But God said to Abraham, "Do not be distressed because of the boy and because of your slave woman. Whatever Sarah says to you, do as she tells you, for it is through Isaac that offspring shall be named for you." And if we're really paying attention, our response is, "Oh, help us out here, God. We need something that seems a little less harsh." And God does help us out in the next verse. Verse 13 tells us that God tells Abraham, "As for the son of the slave woman, I will make a nation of him also, because he is your offspring." So even though Sarah and Abraham are going to cast off Hagar and Ishmael in a manner that seems so uncaring, God is going to counter that. God says, "I've got them." And still Abraham doesn't seem so distressed that he argues or pleads with God or tries to come up with another plan. And so I stand here today and say, I'm not so sure Abraham was so distressed. Abraham gets up early the next morning. He doesn't delay this plan. He doesn't try to talk Sarah out of it. He gets some bread and he gets some water and he says, "Here, Hagar, leave. Adios, Hagar and son. It was nice knowing you." How I wish there was dialogue between Hagar and Abraham. Did Hagar just say, "Okay, after all, she is property"? Or did she yell things that we probably wouldn't want to think that someone in the Bible yelled at someone else? Did she ask Abraham to at least keep their son to raise him, even if she left? I've always been curious about what her body language might have conveyed. Did Abraham at least apologize? There's so much missing, so much human interaction and emotion missing that we would love to know about. Hagar leaves and she wanders around in the wilderness of Beersheba with Ishmael. And Beersheba is what in now what we know as southern Israel. So the Negev desert isn't too far away from there in the south. So it's not the most ideal place to be wandering, especially with a child. But here Hagar is wandering with her son because she's originally from Egypt, and she's been a slave. She's been with Abraham and his family. So where will she go now? Where is safe? Where would be home? Is she going back to Egypt after all of this time? In modern times, and in modern terms, the distance from Beersheba to Cairo, Egypt is 265 miles, which doesn't seem like a lot to us because the joke is if you live in the Midwest and something is less than a 20-hour drive, we'll totally do it. Why fly, right? Kim, you know what I'm talking about. Why fly if it's less than 20 hours? We can totally do this in a day and a half. Google Maps says it would take almost 6 hours by car in light traffic. But imagine you're Hagar, and even if you thought about walking your way back to Egypt, how long would that take? In the sun and the heat, you're at the top of a desert, you have little food, and no water. Long enough to probably fall victim to heat stroke or something worse. Verse 15 tells us that the water has been used up by Hagar and Ishmael. We don't get a time frame of how long they've been in the wilderness, but we know that she probably tried to conserve that water as long as possible. She probably gave most of the water to her son to keep him alive. But Hagar is in the wilderness, and we see over and over and over again in the Bible that the wilderness offers nothing good. The wilderness is inhospitable. Abraham and Sarah went from being family to being inhospitable. This is Hagar's current situation. The water has run out and there's no water fountain nearby. There's no sink to get more water. And there's no bottled water factory by Nestle, Pepsi. We can keep the list going. And Hagar thinks to herself, this is the end. This is where my story and the story of my son ends, and for what? And we're heartbroken with Hagar as she finds some bushes and she puts her child under them. The bushes will protect him for a little while, provide shade, but we know if there's no water, ultimately we know what's going to happen. Now, the scripture says she puts him under the bushes, but we don't know if she did that physically or did she tell him to get under the bushes. Some biblical scholars believe Ishmael to be as old as 14 when these events took place. No one's really sure. We just know that he was born quite a while before Isaac. What we're sure about, though, is that Hagar must be beyond distressed. Whatever their word is for being beyond distressed, she sits opposite her son, whom she didn't ask to have in this situation. She didn't ask for him to be born. She didn't ask to be a mother, but the son for whom she has great love. She says, "Don't let me look at my son as he dies," and she weeps. Weeping of hurt and anguish that bubbles up from her soul, rises through her chest, and is brought forth out of her mouth like an explosion of grief for a child whose fate seems to be sealed. An explosion of grief let loose on an unfeeling and unfriendly landscape. There's no water left to drink, but Hagar is releasing the well of her soul in her weeping. As Hagar is sitting opposite her son with all of her grief and wailing, we're told something interesting happens in verse 17. And God heard the voice of the boy, and the angel of God called to Hagar from heaven and said to her, "What troubles you, Hagar?" Which is almost laughable. But again, the angel says, "What troubles you, Hagar? Do not be afraid, for God has heard the voice of the boy where he is. Come, lift up the boy and hold him fast with your hand, for I will make a great nation of him." The most interesting line I find in that is, "And God heard the voice of the boy." Yet we're not told that the boy speaks in the scripture, at least not out loud. Some translations of the Bible say, "And God heard the cries of the boy," but we're not even told he cries. We're not told anything about the boy other than the fact he's put under the bushes. We just know that he's been banished and might perish, even though God told Abraham that the boy and Hagar would be okay. But we're assuming that Abraham and not God told Ishmael and Hagar that they would be okay. Otherwise, she might not be wailing in the wilderness. But here in the midst of what Hagar and Ishmael perceive to be the end of their lives, the most distressing moment, this moment when they're emotionally raw and they're thirsty, God breaks in. God has heard the voice, the cries of Ishmael where he is, outcast in the wilderness under a bush. The firstborn son of Abraham doesn't have to be back at the homestead to be heard. He doesn't have to be with his powerful biological father to be heard. God has heard this child cry who has been abandoned by his father because of jealousy, greed, and envy. And God says, I am here with you. You are still a child of promise. You are not forsaken or forgotten. God and God's love are bigger than any human emotions. Hagar is told to take the boy from his place under the bushes and to watch over him, to continue to raise him, to continue to love and nurture him. Others may see him as just a lowly child of an Egyptian slave girl, but he's someone great. He's a child of promise, and God keeps God's promises. And since God made a covenant with Abraham, and Ishmael is Abraham's firstborn son, Ishmael will also be made into a great nation. The boy and his mother are not disposable. Later in our biblical history, we learn that this is all the case because Ishmael's descendants are many and are referred to as Ishmaelites, and he actually helps solidify Judaism, Christianity, and Islam as the Abrahamic religions, along with Isaac and his descendants. Isaac and Ishmael are both prophets in Islam, truly tying us to our Muslim brothers and sisters. And so what Sarah tried to break apart physically, God always kept the brothers together. And Hagar, she's propelled from slave girl who was in bondage and who had no choice as to whether or not she was going to give Abraham a son when Sarah couldn't, becomes the mother of a nation, becomes more of that grandmotherly rocking chair fireplace image. She goes from wandering in the wilderness with her son and emptying her soul of tears to God providing a well full of water, and she's able to give her son a drink, and they are able to survive. We're told in verses 20 and 21 that God was with the boy, and the boy grew up in the wilderness and became an expert with the bow. He lived in the wilderness of Paran, and his mother got a wife for him from the land of Egypt. So obviously Hagar did make her way back to Egypt, and her son's wife comes from the same country lineage that she does. Ishmael's name means God hears, and God did hear, and not only did God hear, but we're told that God was with him as he grew up. He grew up in the wilderness, a place where bad things tend to happen, but for Ishmael and Hagar, they're delivered from the bad. They were saved in the wilderness. They found a way in the wilderness to survive with the help of God. They found a way to thrive in the wilderness. Most people don't. This morning's scripture about Hagar and Ishmael in the wilderness is a good reminder for us, especially in this time frame of the world. They didn't ask to be in that situation. They didn't ask to go in the wilderness. They did not go willingly. They were forced. They were pushed. They were banished from the life they knew because of the actions of others. Obviously, Hagar had no choice in having a child. She was property. Ishmael didn't ask to be Abraham's firstborn son. Abraham needed an heir, and Sarah thought that she had worked that out. But when her miracle occurred, when her dream came true, someone else and their child were forced into a nightmare because of very true human feelings and thoughts. But we also have to try not to condemn Sarah, because we know those own feelings and those thoughts. If we were being honest here this morning, we're all human, and that's something to keep in mind. People in the Bible seem larger than life, but we have to remember they were human. Hagar and Ishmael thought that they had met their end in the wilderness, that the end of their stories were written, but what they didn't realize that was with, was that God was with them all along. God wasn't just with them when they were with Abraham because God made the covenant with Abraham. God had made a covenant with them as well. And God heard the weeping of Hagar. God met her in her absolute desolation. God heard the voice of the boy, because no matter where the boy is, he is a child of promise. And so we remember this morning that no matter where we find ourselves, whether it be on the mountains or in the valleys or in the wilderness facing our most difficult moments, God hears our voices because we are God's children. Children of the promise, children of the covenant. And no place is too difficult for God to go and find us and meet us where we are. No voice is too small for God to hear, because even if Ishmael never said a word, God heard him. And I think this is one of the most important takeaways in our society today. If we think we're not worthy of God's attention, God reminds us that even though other narratives around us would have us believe otherwise, none of God's children are disposable. This ends this morning's word. Thanks be to God. In this abbreviated service this morning, we now come to our time of communion. And so if you know our shared confession, please state it with me in a second. If you don't, as I said, we will have it in the coming weeks on the screens. And so let us state what we believe by stating our shared confession. I believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God. On the night that he was arrested, Jesus took the bread, gave thanks, blessed it, and broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Likewise, after supper, he took the cup and he said, "This is the cup of the covenant for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me." For as often as we take this bread and we take this cup, we proclaim his death until he comes again. The gifts of God for the children of God, all are welcome at the Lord's table.
Dear Heavenly Father, we are so grateful to you this day that some of us can come together in this beautiful sanctuary for the first time in months. Once again, we gather around the table, and in eating this bread, we accept your covenant and remember the Christ who gave his own life for us. through your Spirit, help us see the signs of your blessing and love that are scattered throughout our daily lives. Through your Spirit, help us be sources of blessings and givers of your love to those around us. Thank you for your strength and help each and every day. In Jesus' loving name we pray, amen. Let us take the cup.
Bless us, O God, with reflective posture as we receive the sacred cup before us. Help us to remember the anxious anticipation of the Last Supper, the lonely trial of waiting in faithful prayer, the forgiving resolve in the face of betrayal, the righteous silence in the face of persecution, the selfless sacrifice of bearing another's transgressions, and the surrendering faith of one who gives all for those who cannot stand for themselves. With thanks beyond measure, we lift this cup, which binds us to your only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, in whose death we find the freedom to live as your people, and in whose risen life we find the courage to die without fear. Amen. And now let us pray together. Our Father,
who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come.
Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread,
and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors.
And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen. And we shall partake of the cup.
Thank you so much, Lindsay. And Eileen, it's my understanding you'll be here next week, is that correct? So Eileen will be with us. Judy, I think, has a late flight on Saturday. So Eileen will be with you once again. But right now, everyone smile, because I want to show the region. Smile under your masks. Did you get the joke? So we can show the region that we followed their procedures. Things were a bit different this morning, but as I've said, as we go along, things will evolve. When Beth is feeling a little bit better after her knee surgery, she'll hop in and, as worship chair, start figuring out other things we might need to add in or do. So just know that we are grateful that you're here this morning. Actually, I think it's more people than Roger and I anticipated. We were sort of running numbers back and forth. And so we're very grateful that everyone followed the precautions. We're grateful that you're distancing. We ask that you continue to be safe here and outside. And remember that you are loved, you are a child of God. And so go into this week and show others that you are and that they are as well. Amen. Just not shaking your hands. Worked well. Maybe that's why it sounded different.